John Florio was born in London as Giovanni Florio in 1553. His father was Michelangelo Florio, Italian, from Figline Valdarno, Tuscany.
Toscana mia bellissima sei tu.
He was a Francisco friar who converted to Protestantism, and for this reason he was persecuted by the Inquisition. He was imprisoned for 2 years, managed to escape, traveled throughout Italy, Naples, Messina, Venice, Verona, Padua, then he flew to London. In London, he started working for the Dudley's family, Jane Grey, the Queen of the 9 Days.
Queen of the 9 Days, because after 9 days she was beheaded. Yeah, life was pretty hard back then.
He was tutor of Latin and Italian for William Cecil and the aristocracy. But when little John was 1 year old, they had to escape because Mary Tudor, Bloody Mary, ascended to the throne and she restored the Catholicism. Since they were Protestants, they came back to Italy.
Not exactly Italy, but a little village in the Alps called Soglio.
John spent his childhood there, formed by his father, who was a very erudite man with a vast knowledge of the Bible. John grew up in a very religious environment, in a quiet,
maybe too quiet,
place. But when John was 10 years old, his father sent him to Germany, where he studied in Tübingen. Formed by a friend of his father, Pier Paolo Vergerio. After 3 years, Vergerio died. John came back to Soglio, probably traveled to France as well, as Francis Eads, his biographer, suggested.
In fact, he mentions the city of Lyon frequently in his works, so it is possible that he lived there for some years.
And at 18 years old, he arrived in his hometown, London. In London, he loved to call himself not Giovanni anymore, but John. He became the famous translator and writer.
No.
He started working as a dyer for an Italian merchant. At 25 years old, he published his first work, First Fruits, because he wanted to make the development of English language his primary mission. The English language that, as he said,
passed over is worth nothing.
So he began his career both in the languages and in theatre as well.
Theatre? Why theatre?
The First Fruits contains dedicatory poems written by the whole company of the Leicester's men, Richard Tartan, Robert Wilson, John Bentley. They all thank Florio for having worked with them. First Fruits is dedicated to his patron, Robert Dudley, the same family his father worked with. Then he was sent to Oxford. He became tutor of John Lilly, Stephen Gosson and Barnard Barnes, and became friend of Philip Sidney, Samuel Daniel, and gave a huge contribution to euphuism.
Euphuism is the artificial, affected, high-flow style of speaking or writing used by John Lilly, John Florio's student at Oxford, characterized by alliteration, balanced sentences, far-fetched figures of speech.
In Oxford, he met Giordano Bruno, the most revolutionary philosopher in the world. It was love at first sight. And then moving at the French embassy for 2 years. Florio was tutor of Italian Latin of the daughter of the French ambassador, Michel de Castelnau, but was also his secretary, wrote him letters, accompanied him at court.
because Castelnau wanted Elizabeth I to get married with Francis, Duke of Alençon and Anjou, the little frog.
Florio also became spy for Queen Elizabeth I, helping Walsingham with the Babington plot. When Bruno Castelnau left the embassy between 1589 and 1591, John Florio became tutor of the young, rich and beautiful Henry Wriothesley. Wriothesley, third Earl of Southampton. In 1591, John Florio published his second Fruits, beautiful entertaining manual written in dramatic dialogues, both in Italian and English. He also published a collection of 6,000 Italian proverbs.
John Florio loved proverbs.
When he was at Titchfield with young Henry, Florio accompanied him at theatre and wrote the first Italian-English dictionary.
More than 70,000 English words. Whoa!
And he wrote a beautiful dedication to Henry.
In truth, I acknowledge an entire debt. Not only of my best knowledge, but of all, yeah, of more than I know or can, to your bounteous lordship, most noble, most virtuous, and most honourable Earl of Southampton, in whose pay and patronage I have lived some years, to whom I owe and vow the years I have to live.
In 1603, he published the English translation of Montaigne's Essay, a masterpiece of English prose. In 1604, he became groom of the Privy Chamber, working with Queen Anne of Denmark as private secretary and as tutor of her son, little Henry. He also had to deal with foreign ambassadors every day. He arranged masks at court and became close friend of Ben Jonson.
They collaborated a lot.
They wrote Volpone together, and in a copy of the play, Ben Jonson wrote him a beautiful dedication.
To my loving father and worthy friend,
Master John Florio, the aid of his muses, Ben Jonson sealed this testimony of friendship and love. In 1611, John Florio published the second edition of his Italian-English dictionary, Queen's Anne, New World of Words.
140,000 English words.
In 1613, Queen Anne died and John Florio lost his job. He retired in Fulham and King James I couldn't give him the pension that he deserved. Florio, who didn't save money during life...
Hey fellas! Look what I found in my pocket! Look! A year's salary right here! What I call them? Fun coupons!
Suddenly became poor. But he never left his first love, writing. He kept on writing and translated Boccaccio's Decameron anonymously. He made a testament in 1625 and gave his library to his patrons, the Pembroke family, 350 books, English, Italian, Spanish, and a manuscript with all his works handwritten by him. But the Pembroke family, for unknown reason, renounced execution.
Why?
John Florio's entire library, his Italian, French, Spanish books, along with his manuscripts, the unbound volume of written collection of rhapsodies, have since disappeared.